medieval brigands. We were outlaws and criminals and, you know, all these things. And as we were told, Cocker Snook at Society, I think it was Douglas who said that. I think it was completely over the top. We were never any threat to anybody. I get knocked down.
The British Phonographic Industry's annual awards dinner of 1998, Dress to Impress, Carriages at Midnight, RSVP please, was held in the Docklands London Arena, just refurbished to the tune of £10 million. It might have seemed an unlikely spot for a gesture of anarchist outrage and radical grassroots protest. Then again, maybe it was perfect. A swanky, several hundred quid a ticket industry jolly hosted by Ben Elton with the Spice Girls and Dave Stewart all trotting up the red carpet. Oh, and the deputy leader of the new Labour government, John Prescott. A bunch of ex-commune-dwelling squatter punks from Burnley via Armley, Leeds, decided to mark the occasion by throwing a bucket of water over Prescott in a gesture which, while of limited political impact or meaning, certainly guaranteed that Chumbawamba and the colourful, talismanic water chucker Danbert No Bacon received plenty of column inches.
It was a shame because you'd arguably got a lot more younger people engaged with politics in the months that followed the general election in 97. And maybe there was a sense of kind of the young people and the new Labour government were moving in the same direction. But then the fact that John Prescott was at the Brit Awards, you know, maybe that was just more kind of new Labour spin, get him there, you know, make him look cool and trendy, etc.
If John Major had been at the Brits a couple of years before, that would have been utterly bizarre. But if you think about 97, when Labour got back in, they got back in with a young Prime Minister. It was a Prime Minister who could play the guitar. There was very much a feeling of, well, actually, these aren't like the old politicians and they're with us. They're one of us. So former trade unionist from Hull being at the Brits, well, maybe it wasn't so odd at the time.
I think what Chumbawamba were trying to do was trying to be the real kind of, look at us, we're the working class from Leeds. But Prescott was actually a typical working class, genuine Labour bloke. And I couldn't understand why Chumbawamba were pouring a bucket of water over him.
I actually had a lot of time for John Prescott because I come from a working class background. And where politics in the 90s, there seemed to be less working class people appearing on the front line of politics. John Prescott, I could sort of relate to his background. So when Chumbawamba did their protest, I thought, well, actually, I'm not sure about this. I'm not chucking water over a middle-aged man. I'm not sure I get this. But I think it's a difficult act to pull off, to protest against something at a ceremony or a public event of some kind and not appear, I don't know, just a bit lame.
Next morning, No Bacon and the band issued a statement saying, if John Prescott has the nerve to turn up at events like the Brit Awards in a vain attempt to make Labour seem cool and trendy, then he deserves all we can throw at him. But in truth, the whole incident was a fairly odd piece of political theatre. Chumbawamba's label EMI issued an immediate apology, and many wondered exactly what an avowedly anti-capitalist outfit like Chumbawamba were doing on a global multinational like EMI in the first place. What's more, they'd happily performed as entertainers at the showbiz party, hoping to win the award for Best British Single. That single, Tubthumping, and No Bacon's little gesture may well have been the most newsworthy moment of a vague but influential movement that had been growing since the 70s. Peace Convoy, New Age Traveller, Peace Punk, Anarcho Punk, Krusty, Soap Dodger, Dog on String, Green and Woman. The names could be disparaging, but far away from the glitter of the Brit Awards, at road protests and pitch battles and the largest civil arrest in British history, a voice had been given to a part of the British people and their politics and music that refused to be knocked down.
The whole thing about sort of crusties and soap dodgers and things like that, we did tend to look different from other people because we were living in a fairly primitive way. So, you know, we did tend to be covered in mud, things like that. But they were always kind of looking for an angle to villainise us and to demonise us.
The ethics and belief of these people was it was about freedom and it was about having the right to actually say, no, we can choose to live how we want. And we saw it is a birthright to decide that if we want to live in a different way, then why shouldn't we? I could get quite deeply philosophical about that and talk historically through feudalism in the 12th century, that this kind of idea that actually, you know, no, you live how you're told to live, and it still happens. We live in a society that has unspoken rules and ways of living, and people challenge that, basically, and it wasn't liked.
But really, this is all a legacy from the 60s, because Greenpeace and Friends of the Earth were formed around about 1970-71 by hippies. But at the time, they were ridiculed, they weren't taken seriously. But since then, of course, they've become a major force across Britain. And I think what's happened is the generations from that time have moved into civil service and council work, and they've worked their way up through the departments to a position of power and influence. You can't change things by rioting and shouting and holding placards, but you can change things from within.
I think the Greenham impact was we enjoyed living outdoors. We enjoyed living a simpler life. We found we could live, you know, without electricity and running water. And the kind of very creative, active, often very funny, but very serious, non-violent direct action we chose to do, that then fed into other kinds of actions like the road actions and things like, you know, climate rush and even Occupy. You know, there's a number of elements of that that kind of you can quite clearly see the kind of development from Greenham.
I felt really passionate about it from a really early age. I used to go around the local town and I'd pick up cans out of the hedges along the side of the road and fill bin bags and tell my parents that we had to take them to the recycling centre. And this was in the early 1980s. This was before recycling had really taken off. And my mother was pretty horrified that I'd been seen by everybody in town sort of like straggling along the side of the road picking up cans. But they did take the cans to the recycling centre. And so I guess it's always been something that I've been really aware of and wanted to do something about.
I probably wasn't as sort of left-wing and socially aware as I could have been, but I don't think many of my peers were. It wasn't until I went to art college and I met a lot of people who were like that. I found myself suddenly feeling very old and cynical and bitter and saying, well, you know, it's not like that really. You know, face up to the real world, you know, you're too idealistic.
So I'd get my green consumer guide out and think, well, which supermarket do I go to? And if I need to buy insurance, who do I buy my insurance from? And I'd do that. But that was as far as it went. I was still the person who was thinking, wouldn't it be great to have a car and stuff? So I was very much light green. I wasn't the type of person who thought, I'm going to have to move into a teepee in the Brecon Beacons and live a completely sustainable lifestyle existing on mung beans and stuff like that.
Most music fans, most political activists, most rebels of any stripe like to keep their enthusiasms within manageable boundaries and fit them into a relatively conventional life, however passionate and committed they may feel. But for centuries, some kinds of people, strolling players, troubadours, gypsies, showmen, bargees, circus families and the like, have chosen or been forced into lifestyles and cultures that differ from the settled familial norm. They move around, eschewing urban life and city domesticity, often providing music, entertainment or casual work.
It was a community at that time made up of several groups of travelling people, at the time probably known most commonly as the Peace Convoy. It got named that the year before after a brief visit to the Greenham Common Peace Camp. And this group of travellers then came together to travel round and set up free festivals, the free festival scene, basically. It was an alternative culture. It was one I certainly at 15 hadn't experienced. I was completely in the dark about that there was this community of people that were permanently travelling around, setting up these festivals and living a completely different life to anything that I'd experienced before. I knew school was coming to an end. I had exams soon and I knew there were no jobs. All the older friends I had no jobs. They were hanging about the precinct all day. And this seemed very, very, very attractive to me.
From the hippie era of the late 60s onwards, numbers of young people not from traditional travelling communities began to experiment with new lifestyles, motivated by a desire to leave behind normal, bourgeois, suburban family living. They'd got a taste of this at the early free festivals, like Stonehenge, Glastonbury or Windsor, and taken their cue from the freewheeling neo-beatnik nomad philosophy espoused in the movie Easy Rider and tunes like Born to be Wild. Compared to the wide open spaces and endless freeways of the United States, Britain was small and crowded. But then that made it perfect for a small network of free festivals to develop, and like-minded individuals could spend the summer travelling to and fro in a ramshackle convoy of motorbikes, vans, decommissioned coaches, old buses and ambulances that became known, at least to itself, as the Convoy. Within its raggle-taggle ranks were hippies, punks, anarchists and good old-fashioned dropouts, unlikely bedfellows united by the musical upheavals of 1976 and coalescing around events like the Deeply Vale Festival, which convened annually in the Pennine foothills near Bury for the 4 years after punk.
For me, it was a life-changing experience. I can remember coming over the moors and suddenly this scene of 20,000 people there and teepees and buses and a big sign saying, "Welcome to the Free State of Albion." And I walked in and I just couldn't believe that this kind of thing was happening up the road from where I lived. 20 minutes away, there was this whole new world, a different world that I'd never experienced. I discovered these things about eating differently, thinking differently, spending your day differently, the counterculture in a way, the soft drug culture, which did exist there, and it was quite open, and people were selling it, and there were stalls there selling different things, which was obviously, to me, was a bit of a shock, because as far as I was concerned, all this was illegal and it didn't happen, and suddenly there it was. An alternative way of living was being made accessible.
One of the things that was quite interesting was the emphasis on people power, democracy, and it was almost a sort of anti-state feeling. There was a bit of classical anarchist feeling in there. And I remember reading a book on anarchism at the time and thinking, wow, this is brilliant. And before that, my only exposure to anarchism had been really the Sex Pistols, anarchy in the UK. It was very much a wake-up call.
Totally anarchic, organised in a loose sort of way, but you could do literally anything you wanted to, really. Take any drugs you liked, walk around with nothing on, whatever you wanted to do, you could do it. Nobody was bothered, which is, in a sense, is nice, but there were some nutcases there. But it was still good to go, and Hawkwind were always there. You had Hawkwind and later Gong, Egg, those sort of groups, Henry Cow. Steve Village came into that scene.
You know, I knew chart music, and suddenly there were all these bands on that were new to me. I can remember seeing The Fall and Roy Harper, and Steve Hillage was there, I think, played at the time, Here and Now, and all these other bands, which would become part of my life, really, musically.
The music may have been very different, as well as the hairstyles and the dress, but there were the beginnings of a shared ethos and outlook concerning communal living, squatter politics, anarchism and pacifism, nomadic and seasonal lifestyles, drugs, and increasingly, in the early 80s, vegetarianism and animal rights issues.
The Smiths and Morrissey is a really interesting perspective as well, from somebody who's got a very much a certain set of politics and a certain way of looking at things, vegetarianism, animal cruelty, things like that. But if you think about Morrissey, Meter's Murder, The Queen is Dead, things like that, they are very political songs, intensely political songs, but Morrissey and the Smiths do not fill their albums with political songs. They hold their cards and they say, I'm going to talk about this. With Morrissey, it could be about his disappointing love life. But because every track isn't Morrissey saying, I think this and I think that, those certain tracks where his opinions do come forth, and some people might think, what an absolute load of rubbish, but they do stand out much more. A death for no reason. It's not succulent, tasty or kind. It's death for no reason, and death for no reason is murder. And the cart that you cart with a smile, it is murder. And the turkey you festively slice, it is.
I think kind of throughout my life, it was never really very nice because
My mum was quite kind of brutally honest with what came from where. So we were in the butchers and I would say, oh, what's tongue? And she'd show me a tongue sitting and I'd be like, bleh, that's tongue gone. So it was just a kind of gradual ebbing away of things that I would eat. My mum and dad were really good about it, actually. They were really good at finding things that they thought I would eat, which is really nice. Because my sister's much older than me and she'd been through that phase. You know, my mother's like, just a phase she's going through, she'll be fine. And like 30 years later, really wasn't a phase.
These issues also found their way not only into songs like The Smiths' Meat Is Murder, but also Robert Wyatt's whimsical yet chilling Pigs in There.
I pointed as a car got past it. I said, what was that? And the country person who was with me said, that's where they keep pigs. I thought, oh, yes, I see, that's where they keep pigs. And the sun was shining down, and the grass was green, and it was all very lovely driving the country. And I suddenly thought that what that building must have been like from the inside. Pigs. In there. Pigs.
It's a real spine-chilling song. And I think, for me, that in those 2 or 3 minutes, it will have more of an impact on somebody's perspective than a whole album or a whole career of things where people are just saying this, 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 and telling people what to do.
Wyatt also provided the soundtrack to The Animals film, a hard-hitting anti-vivisection polemic seen by over 1 million viewers on the third night of the new Channel 4.
1984, I'm still at high school, and I remember people coming in the next day talking about it. I only saw a bit of it, but a bit was enough. So I think it was a very powerful turning point for a lot of people. I think a lot of people the next day became regular customers of their local health food shop.
I really got into the anti-vivisection stuff from early teens. My involvement then was kind of just joining and signing petitions. I wasn't brave enough to go on a march or stand outside a shop, but I really did support things like the BUAV and National Anti-Vivisection Society. And I probably used to get on my soapbox a lot. Particularly at school, we used to do debates in our English lessons. And whenever it was anything to do with testing on animals, wearing fur coats, vegetarianism, I was always picked to take their argument. And I'm sure my friends must have been fed up of listening to me drone on about it.
When I think about the era of things like road protests and direct action and people getting into animal rights and vegetarianism and things like that, for me, the soundtrack will probably be The Levellers. There's only one way of life, and that's your own,
your own, your own. I can remember that moment being at Stonehenge Festival in about 1983, and that was a turning point, which is I just had the best time of my life living with people who are living this life all year round. I'm going back to Oldham. I probably got to sign on Monday. Stuff it, that is it.
Took 2 years to get it together because it wasn't, oh, I'm just going to jump in a van and see what happens. It was, you know, this is how I'm going to lead my life. And about 5 friends, we saved up. We had little benefit gigs. We had all sorts of things to raise this money that we needed to buy a living vehicle to actually successfully think, right, we're going to start leading a different life here. You know, I can remember 1985 in June, setting off from Royton in this old ambulance and heading south towards Stonehenge, and that was it. We got about as far as Lee, which is about 50 miles away, before we broke down. And that was the start of us having to learn that we haven't got any support from the state or anybody whatsoever. We're completely on our own. We've got to become self-sufficient here. And from that point, we became part of a community of several hundred people.
Out of this scene arose bands such as New Model Army and Chumbawamba. New Model Army came from Bradford and named themselves after Cromwell's well-drilled puritanical fighting force of ideological zealots from the Civil War, a telling choice of name. Their debut album, Vengeance, set out their stall, punkish slabs of rage calling for retribution against all manner of supposed enemies, from drug dealers to Nazi war criminals. They soon established a dedicated fan community called The Family, which became genuinely multi-generational and gendered, and who would travel around the country with the band. Well, I said, son, it could all be yours. You just work hard, pay your dues. Don't be content with what you got. There's always more that you can want. Everybody's on the mic. That's what made this country great. So all I wanted in the end was world domination and a whole lot of money to spend. Everything I touch, everything I see. Fame and fortune, immortality.
My knowledge of New Model Army would be hearing them on things like the John Peel's show. They were a really interesting band because I weren't a massive fan of their music, but I remember famously they were a band that wore clogs. There was a suggestion that was a sort of Luddite anti-industrialisation thing going on. The name itself, which is obviously a reference to the English Civil Wars, and as is the Levellers, of course, that is a reference to a particular movement in the Civil War. And it's interesting that those two bands took their names from a period of protest and rebellion where anything was possible, a time when a king could be beheaded. And I think it's interesting that they used the Civil War almost as their inspiration. Was there a General Chumbawamba in the Civil War? I don't think there was.
Around this time, Chumbawamba convened in the declining West Pennine mill town of Burnley, something of a hotbed for anarcho music and politics, and often a target for the National Front or the newly formed BNP. Their first LP, the provocatively titled Pictures of Starving Children Sell Records, was an attack on Live Aid and Band Aid, which the band saw as a cosmetic gesture that failed to address the real causes of poverty and, worse, was simply a glorified PR stunt for ailing 80s pop aristocrats. Their second album, Nevermind the Ballots, was released in 1987, the year of a third Margaret Thatcher election victory, and was an attack on the whole notion of parliamentary democracy. But Chumbawamba, for all their radicalism, had a strong link with the nation's folk music.
You working men of England, one moment now attend. While I unfold the treatment of the poor upon this land. For nowadays the factory lords have brought the labour low, and daily are contriving plans to prove our overthrow. So arouse you sons of freedom, the world seems upside down. They scorn the poor man as a thief in country and in town.
I listen to a lot of Chumbawamba, and they're very powerfully political. But those two albums, I think, really made me much more politically aware, actually.
At the time, would regard myself as an anarchist. I was very aware that Chumbawamba would probably, you know, absolutely see themselves as an anarchist band outside the left and right of politics, and that the only way is out, really.
I think they've been on the festival circuit forever, but they've never really broken through, and they got this radical background. I remember at the time, if you mentioned Chumbawamba, there'd be a sort of rolling of eyes with people because they think, oh, well, they're well-meaning and I can see where they're coming from. But what was fascinating for me, I think, and what made my eyes roll was that although their thinking was quite radical, their music was utterly dreadful.
By the mid-1980s, The Convoy were regularly travelling the roads of Britain, united by their dissatisfaction with regular society and the Tory government. They made their way from festival to festival, the most emblematic of these probably being the Stonehenge Free Festival, which had been growing since 1972, grudgingly tolerated by the police and bodies like English Heritage.
And at the time, it had been up to 85 quite thriving. There was a network of free festivals right from down south and Stonehenge right up to Cumbria. And Margaret Thatcher seemed to make it a personal mission to stop this happening. I think she was on a bit of a roll with the miners and the success she was having there by brute force. I think it was decided that brute force might work in exactly the same way with us. And to some degree, she succeeded.
I was interested in both the environmental and the anti-authoritarian nature of the protests. You know, they were both important, and even over the years since then, my understanding and my passion for them has grown and deepened on both fronts, you know.
It wasn't that, you know, we've got something to say. We were just smelly, horrible people who were the scum of the earth. And I can remember a Labour MP once saying that we should be shipped to the island in Scotland that has the anthrax on it. That was the left-wing point of view, you know. So we didn't have much hope, you know. We became an enemy. So, of course, the media got on board. I think society always has to have a common enemy. In the 70s, it was communism. Maybe today it's radical Islam, and for a short period of time, it was the miners and the hippies to take people's eyes off what's really happening, which was the place was a bloody mess.
In 1985, the courts banned the Stonehenge Festival, claiming that it was detrimental to the site's archaeological importance. But around 120 live-in vehicles still turned up, only to be met, some 7 miles from Stonehenge, by a police roadblock of 3 lorry loads of gravel. When they halted the convoy, the police, it was alleged, moved down along the line of vehicles, smashing windscreens and arresting occupants as they went. The convoy found themselves trapped in a field, and the chief constable of Wiltshire, Donald Smith, ordered the arrest of the entire convoy on the grounds that they intended to breach the exclusion zone around the monument.
There was no, OK, then we'll turn back. Unfortunately, that wasn't going to happen. There was going to be a lesson taught. There was no get-out here. The only get-out was that field, and people headed into it. The police were behind, the police were in front, the police were to each side, and it was a trap. That day, I wasn't in the beam field. Because of the state of our ambulance, we were several miles behind what was happening. We managed to catch up with people in the aftermath, and it was horrendous, the brutality that was meted out. It surprised me, even after all these years of this slow drip feed of what felt like oppression. And I'm not anti-police in any way, shape or form. They were following orders. They were following orders from a state that had made a decision. But there was brutality, there was violence, there was aggression. Certainly the police that I'd met took me to one side at one point and said, you know, we're all volunteering to do this. Why? Because we want to beat you up.
It was the largest mass arrest in English civil history. But it was to be remembered too for the brutality of the police operation, recorded on video and commented on by several journalists and news agencies. ITN's Kim Sabido spoke to camera on the evening news.
What I've seen in the last 30 minutes here in this field has been some of the most brutal police treatment of people that I've witnessed my entire career as a journalist. The number of people who have been hit by policemen, who have been clubbed while holding babies in their arms in coaches around this field, is yet to be counted. There must surely be an inquiry after what has happened today.
Nick Davis of The Observer reported,
there was glass breaking, people screaming, black smoke towering out of the burning caravans, and everywhere there seemed to be people being bashed and flattened and pulled by the hair. Men, women and children were being led away, shivering, swearing, crying, bleeding, leaving their homes in pieces.
The miners' strike had ended 3 months previously, and the scenes reminded many of the clashes at Orgreave. The police themselves later commented, the police operation had been planned for several months, and lessons in rapid deployment learned from the miners' strike were implemented. Local jails didn't have room for all those arrested. Convoy members were transported throughout the Midlands and even to northern England, and children and their parents were often separated. Photographic evidence of the day is scant. Both the aforementioned ITN and The Observer seem to have lost most of their film and photographs of the day. But the events in that Wiltshire field were commemorated in a song called The Battle of the Beanfield by the Levellers.
know, even though I thought what I was doing was important, even I was intelligent enough to know I'm no threat to the state. I'm just a bloody hippie punk who's going around listening to music. What the hell is all this about? It was ridiculous. You know, I had no delusions of grandeur that we were changing the world.
Despite being a genuine voice of a community and a scene with music and self-expression at its heart, the weekly music press largely ignored or reviled the New Age travellers, referring to them as crusties or mocking their dogs on strings. But this didn't prevent the Levellers becoming one of the most successful bands of their generation, a huge live draw who enjoyed significant record sales, a success made all the sweeter by them having achieved it without the help of the supposed opinion formers in London. But this mood went far beyond mere music.
But the public were very sympathetic. On days when we visited the towns, I had people coming up to me, putting money in my pocket and supporting us, and, you know, it was great. But, you know, I can remember Douglas Hurd coming on to say, I thought, that's it, Douglas Hurd's here now. You know, these are the big guns are out, and once they've decided, then the decision's made, you know. But things like Castle Morton happened. It was a massively big shock to suddenly see something as big as Stonehenge Festival had suddenly re-emerged from what was now a very disparate group of travelling people. And suddenly 30,000 or whatever it was, people were in a field together.
Spiral Tribe's huge free party at Castle Morton Common followed, along with the Criminal Justice Bill in 1994. See our episode about Ebenezer Good. And for 3 years throughout the mid-90s, these crusty youths with their dreadlocks, piercings and colourful knitwear were at the heart of the protests against the proposed Newbury bypass.
And then when the Criminal Justice Bill was introduced, I saw that actually the powers that be aren't going to let you just do your own thing. You can't just go and develop your own way of living and your own society. The powers that be will take action against you. They will introduce laws against you. The mainstream capitalist society won't stand for it.
There was a lot of crossover between different sections of the community, like New Age Travellers and the protest movement. And I think that that was in large part because they were all people who were sort of outcasts from mainstream society. And there was a lot of elements of the New Age Traveller lifestyle which were being criminalised at the same time as the activist community was really active with the Rhodes protests. So, for example, the Criminal Justice Act criminalised people living on traveller sites of more than five vehicles. It also criminalised a lot of elements of the party scene, the whole outdoor rave scene, that kind of thing. So it actually really brought together a lot of people from different walks of life. And I think actually the fact that they did criminalise elements of those different communities at the same time made us a more powerful force because people worked together.
Newbury was the first one that I went and actually lived at. Me and a friend, one day in the first week of January, we decided to go and have a look, see what was going on, and we fell in love with the place. We fell in love with the trees. It was a beautiful, magical place with beautiful, magical people there.
Times are changing, changing time of these. Autumn coming early, setting in the trees. Geese ain't flying south, all the time and now come. Finding it warm enough under the British summer's bulldozers digging down, it's wiped down. Government lies on the dongles and in town. Maybe it's the time of year, or maybe the time of man, but I don't know. Maybe it's the time of year, or maybe the time of man.
Several thousand people in all demonstrated at the loss of 150,000 acres of mature woodland. They lived in the trees, chained themselves to diggers, and constructed a complex series of tunnels.
There were various tree houses there. There was this large tree house. We had a saying, you know, room for one more in the mothership. Whenever somebody new turned up, always room for one more in the mothership. At times there was 30 or 40 people sleeping in there of a night. Which actually, in that cold winter, was quite a bonus.
And it was actually really cosy because when you've got a wood burner going in a tiny space, even in the depths of winter, it gets really, really warm. And, you know, we were very social. We spent a lot of time sitting around the fire, cooking together. We all shared responsibilities of cooking. We fetched water from a local resident who lived about half a mile away, fetched firewood from another bit of woodland. We were always busy, basically, and there wasn't really any tolerance for lazy people on site.
And also the building of community. You know, I think that was one of the biggest things we did in the protests, was actually we built some kind of community that wasn't based around money, that was based around, for want of a better word, love.
And we knew that one day they would come in and they would cut the trees down. So the other side of it was about building the defences. So we had things called lock-ons. It might be an oil drum or some kind of container which had concrete, and it would have a tube in it. So your arm would disappear into this big concrete-filled oil drum or something like that. And then they would have to use angle grinders, drills, whatever, to get you out of there. Anything which would slow their progress. And the whole point, really, was to make it uneconomic for them to build the road, and also to generate a huge amount of publicity, which would hopefully change people's perspective on the whole road-building programme.
When they came to evict us, me and my friend Steve, we climbed up into the higher branches of the same tree, and then they came for us and, well, they asked us, will you go softly or will you go hard? And we decided between us that he would go softly and we'd let them take him out of the tree, and I would put a D-lock, a bicycle lock, round my neck and refuse to come out. They took him off, and then they came for me with bolt croppers and stuff, and then they started being quite nasty to me, trying to hurt me. At which point, I suddenly jumped into a kind of persona of going, oh yes, go on, hurt me, big boy. Go on, do it. You know you want to. You know I love it. At which point, they completely backed off from trying to hurt me and used the minimum force, which of course is what they're supposed to use.
Newbury was really sad for me. I went there as quite a naive sort of 16, 17-year-old. And I remember when I arrived there and I said, this is one of the most beautiful places I've ever seen in my entire life. And I didn't believe that they were going to carry out building the road. I mean, there are 10,000 trees on a 9-mile route, and there was some incredibly ancient woodland. But Newbury sort of almost broke me, because it made me realise that they could beat us down. And I felt heartbroken after that. It really opened my eyes to the way the world works, I think.
Now I just have a kind of profound respect for what those people were doing. I mean, they're like heroes in a way. The kind of peaceful direct action the Newbury bypass people were doing sort of set a kind of level, a certain bar for people doing environmental activism.
One of them, Daniel Hooper, aka Swampy, became the poster boy of the movement, appearing on Have I Got News For You and being offered a record deal by EMI to record a version of I Am A Mole And I Live In A Hole.
When Swampy went on Have I Got News For You, obviously it was a disaster. You know, Ian Hislop and Paul Merton are obviously incredibly intelligent and very witty men, and I really like Have I Got News For You, but at the same time, I think that they really took advantage of him. And it was kind of an example of the whole thing of how he was taken advantage of. They found somebody who they could kind of pin this whole thing on, and I felt really sad about the way they kind of savaged him.
I had no problem with him at all. I mean, sitting in trees, sitting in ditches, good for him, you know. He was a folk hero, wasn't he, really? Chumbawamba would probably be writing songs about him. I think there should be a few more Swampies in this world. We have issues with the environment round here, in the Forest of Dean, that are very different to what I've just moved out from in Surrey, South London. And we could do with more Swampies, because you build as many houses as you like, you build as many factories as you like, but in 30 years' time, what are we going to have left?
But everybody knew who Swampy was. And most people thought, yeah, good on you. I mean, if you've got somebody who is willing to stick two fingers up to authority, most people have a sort of grudging respect for that.
I think the stereotypes the media portray are of probably a bit like what I used to look like. So I used to have very long dreadlocks, quite a lot of facial hair, don't really have jobs, just want to lay about. The reality, though, my goodness, some of the most bright, clever people I've met, people working in universities, people doing all kinds of jobs, people working in permaculture, just so rich and so diverse that it was just such a shame that people didn't get to see that picture.
It felt like we'd unleashed a demon when the whole media storm first started, because we'd courted it. We wanted media attention. We wanted to get our message across and we wanted to change people's minds. But when it actually happened and the media suddenly were banging down our doors, our theoretical, our virtual doors, you know, they wanted to make it into some kind of a soap opera. We wanted to talk about national road building program, climate change, the government policies. They wanted to talk about a 16-year-old girl who was down the tunnel called Animal and a guy called Swampy, because they had nice names and they had funny haircuts. There was also, incidentally, a guy down the same tunnel called John, but nobody remembers John because he didn't have a funny name.
The aforementioned EMI was seen by many as symbolic of all that was nakedly capitalist, a wicked corporate music monolith, not least for their former links with the arms manufacturer Thorn. Which made it all the more surprising when Chumbawamba signed to the label in 1997, especially as they'd attacked the label in many early songs. The band responded to criticisms of hypocrisy by saying, "Our previous record label, One Little Indian, didn't have the evil symbolic significance of EMI, but they were completely motivated by profit." Even more unlikely was what came next. Their single, Tubthumping, was the catchiest thing they'd come up with to date. Perhaps a belated acknowledgement that a good tune will refresh the parts that dialectical materialism cannot reach. It was far less didactic and far more abstractly anthemic than its less than snappy predecessors like Smash Clause 28 or Fight the Alton Bill. Tubthumping, at heart, and it was a big heart, was a defiant drinking song that knew the joys and limitations of alcohol as revolutionary kindling and, amazingly, went to number 2 in Britain and number 6 in America. Hence their appearance at the Brit Awards, with a version of Tubthumping containing a lyric change to "New Labour sold out the Dockers just like they'll sell out the rest of us," and the subsequent dousing of John Prescott by Dan Burt No Bacon. Soon after, band member Alice Nutter appeared on TV advising impoverished fans to steal their CDs from chain stores like HMV and Virgin. Virgin took the CDs off the shelf and put them behind the counter.
I suppose it was a real big drinking culture at the time, and songs like that were out were really popular and used to get played in all the bars. And I think that was when alco pops and things were becoming more and more popular and cheaper drinking. And so it was a real time for going out and celebrating.
When a song is satirical, and I think the same applied to Peter Gabriel, Big Time, or Pet Shop Boys singing about money, it kind of rubbed off on you as being an attractive idea as well as something that was being satirised. And I think probably the same with Chumbawamba is that people did think, oh, binge drinking's quite fun because this song's quite fun. So I think that does happen when people are trying to be satirical.
I think the fact that people don't see it as a political song, they see it as a drinking song, means that people relate to it when they wouldn't necessarily relate to it if they thought it was a political song. It's about tenacity, it's about the fact that the small people in this world will get knocked down again and again by the big people in this world. It's a really sort of simplified way of saying, basically, you know, the powers that be in the world will knock you down, but keep on getting up and keep on fighting back.
Yeah, I was aware of Tubthumping coming out and a lot of people singing it, and a lot of people, when I went into pubs, that were very drunk singing it, almost like it was an anthem to binge drinking, whereas obviously for me, I was reading through the lyrics, that it was a kind of very sad song in a lot of ways. And I think it was very cleverly designed to sound like a drinking song.
I thought it's brilliant that they got a record deal. I think that they deserved it, and I think that they did really good things with the money that they got, and they continue to have the same kind of integrity that they always did, I think. But there were a lot of people that gave them a hard time about it, and I think there was a lot of people who couldn't marry the fact that they had these kind of ideological beliefs with the fact that they'd been commercially successful in a sort of like mainstream way. I don't think the two are necessarily mutually exclusive. You don't have to be poor and unknown to have integrity.
If people talk about, did Swampy sell out because he went on TV to do Have I Got News For You? And did Chumbawamba sell out their anarcho-collectivist principles by signing to EMI? They might say, well, actually, no. We will use their resources and turn it against them. Well, that's one way of looking at it.
Chumbawamba were never to repeat the success, infamy or visibility of 1997 or 1998. Alice Nutter became a playwright and a screenwriter. Dunstan Bruce runs his own film production company and No Bacon lives in Washington State. They gave their blessing to a smaller, acoustic version of the band, recording a couple of albums in a folk vein before disbanding in 2012 with the statement, "We do, of course, reserve the right to re-emerge as Chumbawamba, doing something else entirely, certainly not touring and putting out albums every 2 or 3 years, but frankly, that's not very likely. 30 years of being snotty, eclectic, funny, contrary and just plain weird, what a privilege and what a good time we've had." At the time of writing, Krusty is more likely to be heard with reference to an artisan bread than a youth movement. And yet, old and new, New Age travellers or their children, literal or metaphorical, continue to be knocked down, rise again, and be engaged and involved in direct action, such as the G8 protests and the Occupy movement. Indeed, being kettled has become as much a part of the modern middle-class youth experience as a gap year in Asia.
We had a really good time, you know. We had a lot of fun. It was really exciting. It was a big adventure. We felt like we were doing something incredibly positive. I think what we experienced is we experienced a more powerful sense of community than people generally do these days. People live in a very isolated way. I think that the way we lived on the sites, it was a very natural way for human beings to live together. We ate together, we cooked together, we shared the workload that everybody has to take on. And I miss it.
Yeah, there was lots of fun. A hell of a lot of fun. I mean, there was also heartbreak and tragedy. You know, we did get very attached to those trees, but we also had a lot of fun in those trees.
I think Occupy did a really good thing, which is just putting it right at the top of the agenda in the public domain. And it sort of made the idea of activism not this sort of niche thing for people with long hair to do. And that's nothing against people with dreadlocks and long hair, because we need them. They're the hardcore people who put in hours and hours to make sure protests happen. But you now had actions against particular chains and shops and cafes where you had mothers with small children who felt compelled to take action because it affects their lives and they feel emotionally moved. And that's really exciting.
I don't think people necessarily wanted to listen to what we had to say in a serious way. I think people almost wanted to make us into something that could be not taken seriously, because what we were asking for was a fundamental change in the way that people live and in a fundamental way in which society is being driven forward. And the fact is that people will talk about capitalism now as something that, you know, maybe isn't necessarily the best way for society to move forward. I've heard mainstream politicians now talk on the radio about, is capitalism working? And I think that we were part of the process of raising that question at the very beginning.
I suppose people were becoming, a bit more conscious of stuff like that. I remember my uncle, who was just a, you know, hardline Tory, suddenly wanting to vote Green, which really was surprising.
But it's fascinating how big companies, whether it's Tesco or British Gas or mining companies, which some people would say those are the most environmentally destructive of all, it's fascinating how much time and money they spend on creating something called corporate and social responsibility. They go out of their way to say, well, we try to be sustainable with this, we try to be good to our employees in certain areas. I wonder whether that would have been the case back in the 80s and 90s, if people weren't actually conscious about those things and actually thought these days, these things matter. Would multi-million pound companies spend millions on doing these things? Probably not.
No, people are still campaigning to this day to have another Stone Age festival. There's been talk about another Deeply Vale, and there's all sorts of talk about these things, but it's just, it would be a parody of it. It wouldn't be free, it'd be very organised, it'd be given official permission, and it would be some kind of nostalgia trip for those that want it. It'd be like watching a tribute band.
John Prescott is still active in politics and has become something of a Twitter celebrity. Late in 2012, he tweeted, "I might mark Chumbawamba's split by going out and buying their greatest hit album."
They paved paradise, put up a parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique and a swinging hot spot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot.
I'm Stuart Maconie, and in this episode you heard Peter Castle, Lewis Hall, Den Cartledge, Emma Gifford, Steve Diamond, Rebecca Johnson, Amanda Cox, Madeline Hines, Nick Hale, Donald McKenna, Chris Garrard, Louisa Ayres, Andrew Marsh, and Joe Ward. In the next episode, Light Flight, the folk revival. The People's Songs is a Smooth Operations production.